Do you think evaluation and management coding kind of sucks? If so, you're definitely not alone, but today I'm going to be starting a four-part series breaking down those guidelines of evaluation and management coding. Hey everyone, I'm Victoria, and on my channel, I discuss medical coding, HIM, compliance, auditing, and healthcare business stuff. I just want to thank everyone for all of the shares and likes and new subscribers that I got from my last video on six-figure medical coding. If you haven't checked it out, definitely make sure you see that one. I got a lot of really great feedback from that last video, particularly from my friends in the medical coding podcasting world, such as Brian Quee and Tony Elholmes. Brian says that he's going to be stepping up his game now. I kind of envy some of my friends in the podcasting realm some days because, you know, podcasting, you can roll out of bed and record a podcast. It takes me quite a bit of time to figure out eyeliner and eyebrows and highlighter and lighting in order to get my YouTube videos completed. Some people have asked me if I ever plan on starting a medical coding podcast. So first I want to tell you that I am a speaker, not a talker. That's my big joke. But if you sit next to me on a plane, I'm putting my earbuds in, like, don't talk to me. I'm not someone who is a chit-chatty person. Second thing is I don't really have any intention because of part of that of getting into podcasting. That could potentially change. I did at one point in time have a podcast. It did not make it past episode one. I do have a name for a podcast. Should I ever want to start one, I would definitely call it Unremarkable Will Follow. Now that I'm getting a little bit faster though at editing my videos, I really would like to push forward with getting two videos in a week, a Wednesday morning and maybe a Friday afternoon. Reason being is I want to serve a couple different audiences, people that are maybe more experienced in medical coding, auditing, etc., and benefit from some of those high-level career advice, tips, tricks, what have you, but then also our introductory coders that are looking for stuff like, oh, how do I code this because I need to know it for the exam. So I'm going to try and mix one video a week of career advice, coding, just general stuff, and then a almost how-to code type of video. And today I'm going to be starting a four-part series on evaluation and management coding. Now this is going to be essentials and it's not going to cover the deep dive of what's going to be changing in 2021, the outpatient E&M codes, which I still believe are changing. I do not feel that they are going to push that back because of COVID. So in May, I will be releasing a medical coding comprehensive evaluation and management course on my website, which will cover current evaluation and management scoring, future evaluation and management scoring, and really take that deep dive into the future state of evaluation and management coding for outpatient services 99201 through 99215. I should be finished with recording it later today, and then I'm going to be submitting it for CEU approval. So this will be a paid CEU course that you can purchase on my website, contempocoding.com. So let's start with the basics. What is an evaluation and management service? So if you actually open up your CPT book, this whole section here is technically your evaluation and management service. A lot of people think when they think E&M, just like, oh, office visits or inpatient visits, but there's a lot of different stuff that's E&Ms that's not technically an office or inpatient visit. Counseling, telephone services, newborn care services, chronic care management, transitional care services are technically an evaluation and management code. What I'm going to focus on though for this series are going to be that level scoring. So the codes that need to be scored out and have a level. So our levels are usually 5 on the office outpatient or 3 different levels on the inpatient setting. So we're going to go over how we figure out those levels in evaluation and management. Now, one of the things you have to focus on when you're learning evaluation and management is what I refer to as the key components. So if you look at, for example, the definition of a 99213, it says it's an office or other outpatient visit for evaluation and management of an established patient, which requires at least 2 of these 3 components, an expanded problem-focused history, expanded problem-focused exam, and medical decision-making of low complexity. So today I want to focus mostly on the history component, and then in our future sessions, we'll go over the exam, medical decision-making, and then how to put it all together. When you are sitting for your CPC exam, they're not going to have you actually score out evaluation and management notes. What they'll do is they'll tell you that you have an office visit, it's an established patient, and they did a problem-focused history and problem-focused exam and low complexity, and you need to know to go out and find that 99213 code and pair it up. So that's the sort of leveling you'll be doing for the exam. They'll give you, like, is it a 99213, 99214, 99204, and you'll have to pick out of those which it is based off of them giving you what the level of history is, what the level exam is, and what the level of medical decision-making is, or the level of time. So our key components are our history, our exam, and our medical decision making. Not to get too far into the future, but in 2021, what we're gonna do is be scoring out some of the evaluation and management codes. Our 99201s through 99215s are gonna be just medical decision making. Now, when we're talking about those evaluation and management codes where you have to level them out or score them out, they are based off of those three key components: history, exam, and medical decision making. Time can also be considered if there's a considerable amount of time in counseling and coordination of care, face-to-face or hospital floor time with that patient. We'll talk about that in one of the future sessions, the time component, but also medical necessity. So I'm going to get on my soapbox and do my medical necessity spiel. So a patient can come in and go, oh gosh, you know, I have this little splinter in my finger and we can take care of the splinter. And we could technically, if it's an established patient, we only need two out of those three criteria. So we could do a huge comprehensive history on them, bloat up the note with a whole negative review of systems, do an exam head to toe, also negative because we were just treating the splinter. Technically speaking, it might score out to a level five, a high level, more expensive visit, but really, was it appropriate to bill a patient for a high level expensive visit when really they came in with a minor simple problem like a splinter or a sprain? No. So that's what medical necessity is. So just because we bulked up the documentation with a bunch of unnecessary stuff doesn't necessarily mean that we should be billing at a higher level service. A lot of people will say, you know, medical decision making and medical necessity are the same thing. Not really. Medical decision making can kind of help feed into and almost drive that medical necessity. And I think that's why in the future they're looking at making medical necessity almost the sole factor of how we score out an E&M service. So they do work hand in hand, but are not the same thing. So before I get into the history section, another thing we need to think about is the patient status. So could that be new versus established, or in the hospital setting, initial versus subsequent? And then also the setting of the patient. So is it outpatient or is it inpatient? Skilled nursing facility, observation, etc. Some of our common office or outpatient services are like going to your PCP for your physical exam or to check on your chronic conditions, or going for a surgical clearance, going to see your surgeon in the office outpatient setting, so not having surgery in the hospital or a surgical center, but in their office, or going to an urgent care center could be considered an office or outpatient in terms of which level of service you're selecting. They might have a different place of service for urgent care. Every evaluation and management service, with the exception of preventative care, has to have a chief complaint, and that's in the patient's own words of what their problem is, what drove them into that visit for the day. So it doesn't have to be as straightforward as the patient's chief complaint is. It can be patient presents for sore throat, patient presents for routine diabetic care, patient presents for follow-up of their rheumatoid arthritis, patient presents they fell off of their bike and hit the cement, and have a sore leg, you know, as long as you can tell from that content in there that what their chief complaint is, why they came in for that day, that is their chief complaint. I typically discourage chief complaints like patients here for follow-up or patients here for routine appointment, because that doesn't really tell you what drove that patient in to support that medical necessity. So just expand upon that. The patient presented today for follow-up of whatever, you know, their chronic conditions is listed below, for follow-up for suture removal, whatever they're being seen for in follow-up.
So, focusing on history, there's four different levels of history: problem-focused, expanded problem-focused, detailed, and comprehensive. They are calculated based off of our status of chronic conditions or HPI elements. You can use one or the other, the review of systems, and then the past family and social history. So, status of chronic conditions, they have to be first off chronic conditions. So you have to be very careful with conditions like bronchitis, which could be acute or chronic. It has to state then that it is a chronic condition. Otherwise, it could just be acute bronchitis. And there has to be a status. So at very minimum, it would have to say things like stable. Now, keep in mind that our current status of chronic conditions is going to be different from how we use conditions and other factors like risk adjustment coding validations or even in 2021 when our guidelines change about how we can calculate in medical decision making if a problem was personally addressed by the provider. But when we're talking specifically here about our history and our status of chronic conditions, if it says it's stable, uncontrolled, anything like that, it still counts as the status of the chronic conditions for that HPI status of chronic conditions. So next is our HPI elements: location, quality, severity, duration, timing, context, modifying factors, and then associated signs and symptoms. So location is where the problem is. Is it on the chest, the lung, leg? The quality is a description of the problem. Is it radiating, red, throbbing, sore, constant, achy? Severity could be our pain scale, or like our 1 to 10 pain scale, or it could even be like mild, moderate, severe. And then our duration is how long has that patient had that problem? Has it been since birth? Has it been for the past 2 weeks? Timing is when the problem occurs. So if they have it upon wakening or if they have it after meals. Context would be instances that could be associated with the problem. So if you have a patient that gets migraine headaches every time they're sitting at their computer and staring at their screen for a long period of time, that would be context. Or if you have a patient that was in a motor vehicle accident and then developed, you know, a back problem, that could be a context for that. Modifying factors are things that make it better or worse. The key here is they need to state if it made it better or worse. They can't just say the patient took ibuprofen. They have to say the patient took ibuprofen and it relieved it or it did not relieve it. And then associated signs or symptoms are things that commonly occur at the same time that a primary problem occurs. So for example, going back to our migraine headache patient, if they have migraine headaches so bad that every time they have a migraine, they also get nauseous, nausea would be that associated sign or symptom. So for review systems, a pertinent would be one system, an extended would be 2 to 9, and then a complete would be 10 individually documented, or we could have the pertinent positives and or negatives, and a statement saying all others are negatives. Now, where providers get confused is they'll sometimes say, I reviewed 10 systems and they were negative. Okay, well, that doesn't tell us, per the guidelines, individually, what 10 systems did you review, nor does it say that all others were negative. So it sounds a little bit like semantics there, and it kind of is. So the guidelines definitively say, like, it either has to be 10 individual that you say, you know, head negative for dizziness and migraines, you know, GI negative for diarrhea, constipation, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You have to individually document 10, or you can put maybe in the HPI, patient presents today with, you know, red sore rashes on her right arm. All other systems were reviewed and all other systems were negative. So that's kind of the key there, is that all others are negative. Now, arguably, there's 14 systems, so maybe you could say 14 systems were reviewed and are negative other than the pertinent positives that were listed above.
Now, I would like to dispel the coding urban legend that's still unfortunately circulating that you can't double dip HPI elements in a review of systems elements. So what had happened years ago was there was a Medicare contractor whose words got misinterpreted. And what he was trying to say is essentially, if you say that you have a patient with an itchy red skin rash on the right and left hand, that you can't use location twice for right and left hand. What you can do, though, is use that location and also count that under skin for integumentary. So you can double dip in that fashion. You can't just double dip and use the same location or use location twice. You do have to be careful though with allergies. So you could count allergies either as past history or you could count it under allergies of review of systems, but not both.
Now the other thing to keep in mind is the provider doesn't have to put a little review of systems template in there and mark everything down so that it's easy for you to code. You know, if there's information in the HPI that says, you know, the patient had a sore throat, you still check that little box for ears, nose, and throat because they still remarked about the throat, even though it doesn't say, you know, little box there, you still abstract it. This is an abstraction process. So you have to abstract everything from the medical record. You know, it's not the provider's responsibility to put it in a neat and tidy box for you. Even going on to our next example, past family and social history. Past family and social history, so your past history is your experience with certain illnesses or injuries, operations. It can even be your past experiences with allergies. Family history would be things like, do you have a history of cancer or psoriasis or heart disease? That's a big one. So things that your blood relatives might have that would also put you at risk. And then social history, depending on your age, could vary quite a bit. So if it's a pediatric patient, it could be, are they in daycare or school, involved in sports? For adult patients, you know, what is their occupation? Do they smoke? Do they drink? Pediatric patients, would it be, is there smoking in the house? And then also some things that also get missed for our adult patients is I've even seen and almost missed myself. It'll say in the HPI, oh, the patient presents today with their wife and she said the patient and I almost forgot to check the box. You know, part of social history is also marital status. They said they have a wife, so you can check the box there when you're scoring out your level that, you know, their marital status is clearly married because they have a wife. Now, depending on what type of evaluation and management service you're scoring out, a complete history might be two history areas or it might be three history areas. So it tells you down here in your typical scorecard, and this is one I just kind of mocked up based off of what most scorecards look at. So for a complete history, it could be two or three areas depending on what type of evaluation and management service you're looking at. So it would be two history areas for complete if you're looking at established patients for office visits or emergency departments. You would need three of them for new patient office visits, for domiciliary care, home care, initial hospital care. So that's a big one. If a patient's getting admitted to the hospital, they're going to want that comprehensive history on them. And then for initial hospital observations and initial nursing facility care, they're going to want all three of those history areas for past, family, and social to get a complete history. Pertinent history would just be like one area. Now, once you've scored all this out, the guidance for how you calculate your level of service is if one column contains three circles, that's the level of service you get. You draw that line down, and that's to identify the level of service. And if no column contains three circles, then you go the circle furthest to the left. So let's take a look at that. So here's our patient that has three HPI elements. They only have one review of systems and then no past family and social history areas. So we have in this one the nice three columns in a row where we know that this is expanded problem focus because everything we have in a row. And remember we said that it has to be the status of chronic conditions or those HPI elements. But now in this example, our circles are all over the place. We have one in this column, we have one in this column, and we have one in this column. So if you look at the guidance, it says if no column contains all three circles, we go to the circle that is furthest to the left to identify the type of history. So the furthest we have to the left is this one here for those HPI elements, and that drops us down to an expanded problem-focused history.
An important thing in regards to history, and there's been some changes on this recently, is who can document that history. So technically, ancillary staff can document any components of the history, the review of systems, past history, HPI elements, but what Medicare says is that the provider has to in some way prove that they reviewed that information. So these EMRs these days are so savvy, they can just pull in all of this, you know, garbage from the chart, past history, medical histories, you know, diseases they haven't had, you know, it'll say, oh, patient had a URI back in 2005, and it'll still somehow be on their problem list, and they'll pull that in as past history. But if it shows that they just dumped that in from the EMR, that the nurse took that 7 years ago, and now they're just pulling it in, they have to validate it in some way. So there has to be some kind of notation from the provider that they reviewed and updated that information up to and including if they have those intake forms that the patient completes themselves, that provider still needs to notate somewhere that they reviewed that review of systems or patient intake form that's scanned into the electronic medical record in order for it to count towards the leveling of that evaluation and management service. Who knew so much could go into just the history component of a simple office visit? So that's all I've got for the history component. In our next portion of the series, we're going to go over the exam, the 1995s and the 1997s. Hope you found this helpful. If so, make sure you leave a comment and like and share with your friends. Follow me on Instagram, and then don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell so that you never miss another episode. I'll see you in the next episode, and until then, just keep on coding on.